Good morning, everyone. Let's begin our worship. The Lutheran Church of Australia acknowledges that our loving Creator God first gave the land on which we are placed to the peoples of the First Nations who have walked and cared for this land since before recorded time. At Holy Cross, we particularly acknowledge the Ngunnawal people. We thank God for the land's traditional custodians and pay our respects to elders past, present, and emerging as we travel this journey of reconciliation in Australia. Once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's stand as we sing our first song this morning, The Power and the Glory. Please be seated, everyone. Friends in Christ, let us draw near to God, our Father, with a true heart, to confess our sinful nature and ask him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Together we confess. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we confess that we are born as imperfect people and are unable to escape our sinful human nature. By our own understanding and strength, we cannot believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, or come to him. And for his sake, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Christ lived, died, and was raised for us to bring us new life and the assurance of God's pardon and love. So, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, I announce the grace of God to all of you. You are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. His love and forgiveness set you free, strengthen you to do his will, and keep you in eternal life. The peace of God be with you.
We stand as forgiven and loved children of God. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
And let's pray for faith in Jesus our Saviour. Together.
Loving Father, when we were captive in the darkness of sin and death, your Son rescued us and brought us back to you. Teach us to trust in him and to live as your people. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Provided for myself a king among his sons. Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked at Eliab and thought, "Surely his anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest. He is with the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was a grown man, and his wives were expensive. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from Ephesians chapter 5. For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness. Rather, expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything is exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And it comes from John chapter 9, reading from verse 1. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it's someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud and spread it on my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been born blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? But then, does he now see? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that although I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. What do you want? Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me, so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshipped him. Jesus said, "I came into the world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to Jesus, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Now this is a special children's address only for the classy children. Ah, here they come. Only for the good ones. No sinner children can come down to this children's address. Now the story we heard today that Ian read is a long one, but it is famous. It sounds like it's about a man who was blind and Jesus healed him. And it sort of is, but how can that help us? Because look at you and me, we're not blind. We can see. But you know, the real point of the story, it's not really about the blind man. But we're all like the blind man, really. We're all just a little bit broken. None of us are quite perfect. Sometimes you can see what's wrong with us, like the blind man who was beside the road. Everyone could see what was wrong with this man. Everyone else except him, because he was blind. Look at me. Now, am I blind? No. I'm ruggedly handsome, for a 50-year-old anyhow. But you know, there's a part of me that's a little bit broken too, even though I can see. You see, some things that are wrong with us are easy to pick up, like a blind man, or like a person in a wheelchair. Easy to tell that they've got something that's not quite right with them. But the truth is, my brain doesn't work quite like yours does. It's a little bit wonky. In fact, I can't spell. I am awful at spelling. I'm almost the worst person you know at spelling. I have a very bad sense of direction. I get lost all the time. And I couldn't sing in tune to save myself. So some people think I'm just a bit lazy and I don't spell well and I can't spell because I just couldn't be bothered to learn. In fact, that's what they thought when I was at school. But scientific tests have shown that Gary is dyslexic. Everybody I know, though, is a little bit broken. Sometimes you can see it, like a blind man or a person in a wheelchair. Sometimes you can't see it at all, like my dyslexia. You can only tell when I try and spell something. Dyslexia. It's actually a funny word for someone who can't spell. I've got a little wonky brain. You know, every superhero has a weakness. For Superman, it's kryptonite. Every superhero has a weakness. So Jesus comes along and he heals the blind man. He opens his eyes and he can see. Jesus hasn't fixed my dyslexia. I still can't spell. Yet he fixed me up in front of God and in front of everybody else too. Jesus says, when God looks at me, he sees the perfect Gary. The Gary that he intended. The one that can sing better than Cameron. The one that can spell better than Suzanne. The one that looks still ruggedly handsome. So when God looks at you, he doesn't see those little things that are wrong. He sees the perfect you, the best you, all of the things looking just right. And then just like Jesus, he says to your family and to everyone around you, just because you're not quite perfect doesn't mean you don't need each other. Because even though God sees you as perfect, he knows that we are all a little bit broken, and that means we need each other. We can't do everything on our own. I can't spell to save myself. I need people to help me. I met a famous disabled person on Thursday. His name is Dylan Alcott, and he was the Australian of the Year last year, and he is permanently, until he goes home to God, in a wheelchair. And he said, sometimes I hate my disability, but for the last 10 years, I've loved it. He also said something else that I really loved. He said, able-bodied people, people who don't have a visible disability, able-bodied people are just disabled people in disguise. And I love that. Because just because we've got something wrong with us doesn't mean that God doesn't think we're special. That God doesn't enter into our lives and heal us and love us. My brain's still a bit wonky, but he gave me to all of us. So together, each of our disability could work together to be great as a team. So the fact that we are all God's children, our brokenness, our slight disability, our blindness doesn't matter, because the way God sees us and the way God calls us into our family is to love each other just the way we are. And to celebrate our weaknesses and our differences and to work together to be stronger. So, this morning when I listen to those musicians, I'll never be able to sing well, but I'm going to belt them out because they lead me on. And next time I sit down at my computer to write a sentence, I'll need someone to help me. But God looks at me and says, that makes you whole. Someone working with you. Now, there is something wrong with you. I don't know what it is yet. You look practically perfect, all three of you. I've got an inkling we'll find out one day, but it doesn't matter. Because when God looks at you, he sees that perfect person that he created. And he sent you into families to embrace you, care for you, and compensate for those little things that aren't just perfect. So run, walk, or slip back to your seats, and we'll sing another song. Off you go. Carefully to.
I never really realized what it meant to be able to see. I walked in darkness every day. Having been born blind, I spent most of my days begging for alms. There wasn't much else for a blind man to do. People looked down on me because of my blindness. I'd overhear the remarks. It's his fault. He was born blind. He must have committed some horrible sin. Or it's because of his parents. What did they do? It made me feel like dirt. Like mud. I suffered in silence. Some days I felt blind in more ways than one. I had no idea what the future would hold. It seemed I had no purpose in life except to be here as some sort of punishment for some sort of unknown sin. But then, Jesus saw me. And what he said and what he did next changed my life forever. It was an ordinary day. I'd taken up my usual spot by the city gate. A steady stream of people walked by, many ignoring my pleas and open palm. I heard a small group approaching and heard that familiar question. Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents? That he was born blind? I prepared myself for humiliation, for yet another biting remark. But the response surprised me. Neither this man nor his parents sinned. But this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. What? I was born so that God's works might be displayed through me? I heard the gasps, the questions. Then I heard someone spit on the ground. What was going on? And then someone touched me, smearing something over my eyes. Mud. It was Jesus. He spoke with such authority as he bathed my blind eyes with mud. Go, he told me, wash in the pool of Siloam. I went. I didn't know what to expect, but Jesus said that God had a plan. Those were the first words of hope I had ever received. Of course I would go. When I came up out of those waters, nothing could have prepared me for what happened. Light filled my vision. I could see. I was so happy. But some of my neighbors weren't happy at all. They did not believe that I was the blind beggar. And when I said that Jesus had cured me, they demanded to know where he was. I told them I didn't know. It had been a Sabbath day when Jesus healed me, and some of my neighbors dragged me off to the Pharisees, who asked me how I was able to see. They asked me for my opinion about Jesus, and they sent for my parents to verify my identity. The Pharisees got very agitated and could not agree. They hurled insults at me. I tried to tell them that Jesus was sent from God, but they were furious and said, "You have been a sinner since the day you were born. Do you think you can teach us anything?" I remember thinking, nobody can teach you lot anything, but kept my mouth shut. The Pharisees then banned me from the synagogues. They had their own blind spots. How could they not see who Jesus really is? Not long afterwards, Jesus stood before me and asked, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And I said, "Who is he? Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus spoke, "You have seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." I fell before him in worship. "Lord, I believe. I believe."
Please be seated, everyone. Dear friends in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and His Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? How many of us today would still believe that sin causes suffering and disease? I think most of us would think that we're more sophisticated than that. We would not attribute blindness, for instance, to sin, just as we wouldn't attribute Gary's dyslexia to sin. We'd look for some other physiological reason. Your addled brain, for instance, Gary. Yet, it's surprisingly common to hear people mouthing quite simplistic causes of pain and suffering, isn't it? And one that Suzanne and I had heard recently was in relation to Suzanne's diagnosis of breast cancer. Words to the effect that cancer was part of God's plan for Suzanne. Now, you could be forgiven for thinking that Jesus' response to his disciples when they put this question to him sounded a bit like that, didn't it? Jesus' answer was, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him." Was Jesus really saying that God planned this man's blindness so that he could perform a miracle and heal him? That actually sounds like a rather manipulative sort of God, doesn't it? Now, we know our universe was not created flawless. Tectonic plates crash into each other, causing earthquakes and tsunamis. The world's weather patterns move in unpredictable ways, sometimes leading to droughts or floods. And some people are born with a disability, such as blindness or dyslexia. This is the world we live in. It's an open-ended, constantly evolving creation. You might ask why God created the universe this way, and the short answer is we don't know. But rest assured that God also lives in this constantly evolving creation, in this world of risk and danger. God is here in and with us. So I don't think God intentionally did not intentionally make this man suffer blindness from birth so that a miracle cure later in life would somehow reveal God's greatness. I don't think that's how it worked. Rather, God overruled the disaster of this child's blindness so that when that person grew to manhood, he might, by recovering his sight, give glory to God in the face of Jesus Christ. But along the way, this man has to endure two major setbacks before he recognizes Jesus as God and worships him. He's rejected by his family and neighbors, and then he's excommunicated, thrown out of the place where he's worshipped, his local synagogue. And from the time he gains his physical sight and through these dramatic setbacks, his faith grows. It grows from something that starts out quite childish. "This man opened my eyes and I see." He seems quite happy with that. "It's all I know," he says. Maybe some of us too are happy with such a level of knowing God. But like the blind man, so also with us, we can't keep living and walking the journey at that level. It simply won't stand up in difficult times. There's no such thing as blind faith. And childish faith, too, is not admirable. But this man's faith doesn't remain childish. Throughout the story, it grows. His faith grows to the point where not only can he physically see, but his faith enables him to see Jesus as Messiah, as Lord. You see, faith is seeing. It's not blind faith. Closing the eyes as if certain things are just not there in our lives. So his faith allows him to see Jesus, despite or perhaps even because of the persistent pressure from his family and the church officials who want him to explain Jesus more clearly. Now, I reckon we could feel sorry for this man in some way, couldn't we? He didn't ask to be healed. He didn't ask to have Jesus come into his life. Jesus just came. He didn't ask to run into conflict with his family and his church and its leaders and authorities. He was almost forced into it. He might have thought, I wish this hadn't happened at all. But it had. He was caught on that wheel of faith. And in the end, he's thrown off, cast out of his own religious community, separated from his people, God's people, separated from his own family. At the end of it all, he's alone. He's expelled, just like the demons and evil spirits that were expelled by Jesus. He experiences the loneliness of faith, the abandonment of his community, which he might rightly understand to be the same as abandonment by God. Perhaps many of us might experience something similar in our lives. Have you ever had that feeling of being abandoned by God? And yes, our faith might fall into an abyss at some time or other. And when the eyes of faith are opened and we see things as they really are, we can also see abandonment by God. So this is crisis time, isn't it? This is where the blind man now is. But stepping into that crisis comes Jesus, who on hearing that they had cast him out, found him. The gospel in one short sentence. The rejected is found. Jesus, who himself cried out, my God, why have you abandoned me? Finds the abandoned man. Finds you too. Finds me in our abandonment, in our being cast out, in our loneliness, in our alienation from God and from each other, in our vulnerability and in our pain. Perhaps this is why this story is read in Lent. And that's where the faith miracle really kicks in. When faith looks like it's reached empty, when it's hit rock bottom and can't go any lower, Jesus finds us, opens our eyes wide, and asks us, do you believe in the man from heaven? The one who was lifted up on the cross, just as the snake was lifted up by Moses in that wilderness? The one whose flesh we now eat and drink. Now, like the blind man, we too can see Jesus. And we see him in that bread and wine that we will have in a few minutes' time. And like the blind man, we can say, Lord, I believe. The blind man's faith has gone from childish, this man I don't know anything about, to Lord, the giver of life, the giver of sight, the one who opens my eyes, the one who finds me in my lostness, in my abandonment, in my loneliness, in my crisis of faith. And like the blind man, we too can worship our Lord. This mourning, of course, in the end, it's not in obviously not our faith that saves us. It's the faithfulness of the one who finds us and speaks to us. It's the faithfulness of the man from heaven lifted up on that cross. The one who is the way, the truth, and the life. And he comes to us this morning. He comes to us in this meal, finds us, and speaks to us. This seeing faith, then, which God's Spirit gives us, will empower us too to stand and proclaim God's new kingdom. The blind man, unlike his parents, has the courage again and again to say what he knows, to speak truth to power, to tell what he can about the amazing grace by which he's been touched. And that's what our faith can do for us as well. So in the end, this story is fundamentally one about grace. And the blind man sums it up so beautifully for us. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. So, Lord, let your servant depart in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation. And now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Remain seated as we together say and confess our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Your offering will now be received, or you can give your offering in those ways that are listed on the screen. And we'll sing the next song, but please remain seated for this.
Just as I am without one plea, but that your blood was shed.
Receive, we'll welcome God in heaven. After each petition of this prayer, I shall pause briefly, and the congregation should say, Lord, hear us. As we hasten towards Easter in this time of Lent, let us turn to God in prayer with complete trust that our petitions will be answered. We pray for all peoples of the world, those suffering the consequences of natural disasters, earthquakes, floods, drought and famine, those enduring the sufferings of conflicts between nations, those enjoying immense wealth and luxury while ignoring their neighbour existing in poverty. May all be motivated to stand together and share equitably the gifts that you have placed in this world for us to steward responsibly. Lord, hear us. We pray for the leaders of our church, the national and district bishops, our fellow congregations, pastors and lay leaders in the Canberra region. May we all work graciously, cooperatively and in harmony to be a light to the communities in which we are placed. Lord, hear us. We pray for the people of God that the words of St. Paul that we heard in the reading from Ephesians earlier this morning may be fulfilled in us so that we may have the grace to become the children of light in a world of darkness. Lord, hear us. We pray for the people in authority, especially the leaders in Australia, that they may work for unity and peace in our nation without blindness of prejudice. Lord, hear us. We pray for the people who are burdened with suffering. We pray especially today for those afflicted with illness, that they might find comfort through their family and health carers. Among us, we commend Klaus and Irene, Joan, Albert, Suzanne, Dennis, Joanna, Jean, Laurie and Fiona to you. Lord, hear us. We pray for those gathered here today in God's name. May we have the grace to discover our blindness and call out to God for help, and through this receive insight and be able to be alive to the kingdom of God. Lord, hear us. We pray for parents, teachers, and all who teach others the stories that draw them into the life of Christ. Give them strength to continue their ministry and bring others into the light of knowledge and truth. Lord, hear us. Merciful Shepherd, look down on your flock and listen to our prayer as we turn to you in time of need. We make this prayer in the power of the Spirit, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let's pray together the prayer that Jesus himself taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen.
Please stand for our final song this morning.
Thank you. soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Please be seated. Go now and live as children of the light. Seek what is pleasing to the Lord. Expose the unfruitful works of darkness and commit yourselves to the works of God who sends you. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord look upon you with favour and give you his peace. Amen.